Hello everyone and welcome to our worship today. I'm here sat out in the garden with wisteria in the background and the birds singing and the lambs making their usual noises, and it's just a beautiful day. Today is the day that we celebrate the birthday of the church, and what an amazing day that was when those disciples were in that locked room. And you're going to hear later the story of Pentecost, but just for now, some words as our call to worship. The Spirit of the Lord is with you. Strengthening God, send forth your Holy Spirit. May your breath give us life this day. Welcoming God, send forth your Spirit upon us. May we be at one with you and with each other. Challenging God, send forth your Spirit upon us. May we break down the barriers that divide us. Healing God, send forth your Spirit. May we use our gifts to heal this broken world. And loving God, send forth your Spirit upon us. May we sing of your love forever. Speak to us through the tongues of Pentecost. Stir up our longings with the excitement of Pentecost. Unite our communities with the inclusiveness of Pentecost. Bless our nations with the surprise of Pentecost. Until our lives overflow with the gifts and the grace of your Spirit. And we serve one another and you in your strength and to your glory. Amen.
Thank you.
And so now we're going to begin our praise as we sing together, Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Today, experience the Holy Spirit in a way that perhaps you've never experienced before.
Acts 2, 1 to 21. The Holy Spirit comes at Pentecost. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Philomia, Egypt and parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we heard them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues." Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said, "They have had too much wine." Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. "Fellow Jews, and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk, as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show you wonders in the heavens above and signs in the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will turn to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved."
Jesus appears to his disciples on the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together with doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Amen.
And so now I'm going to introduce you to Mariette Sheriff, who has brought our message for today. Thanks, Marian. I know it'll be great.
Whit Sunday. Whit Sunday was always an exciting day for me when I was a little girl. There were other occasions, of course, in the year that I got quite excited about. Christmas, that was good. Looking forward to decorating the Christmas tree and all the things that go with it. Easter, chocolate eggs. Whitsuntide, new clothes. Whitsuntide was an occasion when I could guarantee I would have something new to wear. Because on Whit Friday, I would be in the church procession, walking behind the brass band around the streets in our village area. A great deal of preparation went into Whit Friday processions. I suppose I must have been a teenager before I realised that Whitsuntide and Pentecost were one and the same thing. On reflection, I think it was a great way for the churches to witness to their communities about the coming of the Holy Spirit and the birth of the Christian Church. In the second chapter of the Acts of the Apostles that we heard, we have that wonderful transformation of those first disciples receiving the Holy Spirit. Jesus had told them to wait. To wait for the gift my Father promised. He told them they would then be able to go on to baptize people with the Holy Spirit. Up until now, these disciples had been, I suppose, what we could call in lockdown. They'd been waiting for the promise that Jesus had told them about. They would all gather together in one place. And it was in such a place that the sound of the violent wind came and filled the house where they were sitting. They saw tongues of fire sitting on each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. Wow! This was really something. You know, when the Holy Spirit came upon them, those disciples and others heard the sound of that very strong wind. I'm quite interested in weather forecasting. I do like to know when the weather is likely to change. And I particularly like to know if there's going to be any stormy weather or difficult weather. Forecasting the weather has become a very scientific exercise, hasn't it? The weather chart appears on television with the isobars and the wind speeds, helping us to follow how the coming weather fronts can be tracked. No such information for those disciples who waited in Jerusalem. So suddenly, unexpectedly, this strong wind came, and it makes a real impression on them. We now know that various strengths of wind force are sometimes referred to by different words. Some are called gales, some are called hurricanes. And of course, we are now have a forewarning system of such weather patterns. Not so for those first disciples. If a gale or particularly a hurricane is forecast, people are told to prepare for its arrival and to take cover. Batten things down because they might be damaged or even destroyed by the power of the wind. But you know, the wind of Pentecost is something that we should be out in, not hiding away from. We should be letting it sweep through our lives, our hearts and our imaginations. Those first disciples were transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit. Up until this day, they'd been very careful, hadn't they, to stay together, sharing accommodation, finding security in each other's company. But now they were bold and openly speaking about Jesus to everyone. It's important to remember that the wind of the Holy Spirit came from heaven. God's presence was in this wind. The power of the Holy Spirit will transform earth with the power of heaven. God transformed those first disciples from unsure, frightened people to bold preachers who were taking the gospel of the risen Lord to everyone. They were all together in one place. The Spirit comes to unite, not divide Christians. The second thing to note is that everyone heard the message in their own tongue. How amazing is that? No need for translators. All heard what the message was about. Many years ago, Dean and I were on holiday on a Greek island, not sure which one, and during our visit, we went to a monastery. I chose to wear a t-shirt that I'd bought just a couple of days before. On the front of the t-shirt was a story of a Greek legend, written in Greek. One of the monks there took this as a sign that I spoke fluent Greek. Oh dear. I had to explain, as he began to address me in Greek, that I didn't understand him. No such problem on that first day at Pentecost. The crowd could understand what the disciples were saying as they preached the word of God. The message of the risen Jesus is for everyone. There are no barriers which God cannot cross. Jesus has sometimes referred to the fact that God's love was for all, that it knew no barriers of race or language or gender. Now it's clear. all heard the message in their own language. The gospel we preach is just the same. There are no barriers. This is good news for everyone. Here we have in Acts chapter 2, a group of frightened, largely uneducated men and women who quickly became a force to be reckoned with, not only in their locality, but across the known world. They began to use language in quite a new way. We are all called to be people of God's Word. God's Word can never be controlled or contained within a tight framework that we invent so that we can keep it within the limits that we feel we can deal with. No, God's Word is free for everyone. Not everyone will be given similar opportunities to witness to God's Word. Some will be sent to preach. Some will be sent to work quietly and patiently in all areas of life. But all are given the opportunity to offer God's life-changing love to others. One thing is clear. God longs to give his gift of the Holy Spirit to everyone who asks him. What the Spirit will do when it comes, that's anybody's guess. But be prepared for some rather drastic spring cleaning. Be prepared to think differently. But one thing's for sure, when you accept the Holy Spirit into your life, you will bring God's glory to others. I began by telling you about my new clothes for Whitsuntide. Well, when God's Holy Spirit comes into our lives, we are made new from within. Just like those first disciples, we will be led into new areas of work for God. We will see opportunities to spread his good news. We will be bold in our faith. There may be times when we feel we can't do this. Stop. Breathe in God's Spirit and become part of the living gospel which will transform earth with the power of heaven.
We now sing Wind of God, Dynamic Spirit, breathe upon our hearts today, that we may your power inherit. Hear us, Spirit, as we pray. Thank you.
Dear loving Father, we live in an alien world where people are needlessly dying, where families are kept apart, where loneliness wears down the vulnerable, where the feared loss of livelihood torments the worker, where the low paid bear the burden of care. But we have heard you say, when you're on your knees and answers seem so far away, you're not alone. Stop holding on and just be held. Your world's not falling apart, it's falling into place. I'm on the throne. Stop holding on and just be held. And so, in confidence and faith, and trusting in your amazing love, we bring you our concerns for others. We pray for health and care workers, that you may support and protect them. We pray that they may be given the resources they need to keep them safe. We pray for all those whose loved ones have been taken from them by the pandemic, especially those who have given their lives caring for others. We pray for those who are still infected and for their family members. Give them courage to face this time of worry and suffering. We pray too for all those suffering from poverty and homelessness, and for those volunteers in soup kitchens and food banks who are working tirelessly to support them. We pray for those who are researching new medicines so that effective treatments to combat COVID-19 may speedily be found. We also think of those countries who lack adequate resources to fight coronavirus, that they may be given help and support from the richer nations. We pray too for those whose wealth has kept them untouched and unharmed by the pandemic. Touch their hearts with a spirit of compassion. May they be prompted into acts of kindness and generosity towards those in need. Dear loving Father, when your people were enslaved and displaced, you led them to a land they could call home. Rescue us from this exile and lead us back to your promised land, a land where each person makes a fair contribution towards financing the community's needs, where adequate resources are made available for hospital and community care. A promised land where each care worker from this country and from abroad receives an income which reflects their vital contribution to the health of our community. A land where every one of your children is recognised and loved as a valued member of your family, where every street rings with the sound of play and laughter. All these prayers we ask in the most precious name of Jesus. Amen. Let us join together in the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
final hymn this morning is the Charles Wesley hymn, "O Thou Who Camest From Above, the pure celestial fire to impart. Kindle a flame of sacred love on the mean altar of my heart. Let's invite the Holy Spirit to kindle that flame in us and to confirm our desire to work and speak and think for Jesus." And so we come to the end of our worship today. I brought you to a familiar place, and just behind me there is the tree that the children have decorated with stars and rainbows. It's a tree that we decorate at Christmas. It's a tree where we celebrate, and today we celebrate at Pentecost in true style. We say thank you to Mary and Sherry for that inspiring message. And we look forward to next week, where hopefully we've got a big surprise in store. I can't give secrets away, I'm sorry. I'm just going to let you look at the scenery here as I give a blessing. We're going to then listen to a new Graham Kendrick song, and it's been written for the London Marathon, but of course that's not taking place. But we've been invited to use it however we feel is right. So be happy, be blessed, and go in Jesus' name.
A little bit of love goes a long, long way. A little love, a little love, a little bit of love, and I'm on my way. A little love, a little love, a long way, but we'll get there together. A long way, but we'll get there soon. Along the way we can lean on each other. A little love goes a long, long way. A little love, a little love, a little bit of love, and the sun comes shining. A little love, a little love, a little bit of kindness and someone smiling. A little love, a little love, a long way, but we'll get there together. A long way, but we'll get there soon. Along the way, we can lean on each other. A little love goes a long, long way. A little love, a little love. Little drops of rain can trickle down into a puddle, and the puddles get together, making streams that make a river. The rivers fill the valleys with a roaring and a rushing, and the little drops of rain have made a wide, 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 wide ocean. A long way, but we'll get there together. A long way, but we'll get there soon. Along the way, we can lean on each other. A little love goes a long, long way. A long way, but we'll get there together. A long way, but we'll get there soon. Along the way, we can lean on each other. A little love goes a long, long way. A little love. A little love, a little love.